Hello, friends.
Welcome back.
My name's Ramon.
How are you today?
So, if you guys didn't go see the review on the Caught Flawless Complexion sunscreen that I did recently, I loved it. But I had a lot of people in the comments specifically comparing that one with their own experiences with the Caught Sensitive Skin sunscreen. And those experiences were very different. So I was like, oh, I need to try this. And thanks to State of Kate again, who was the one who sent me the Flawless Complexion from Caught, I also have the Sensitive Skin one. So that was prioritized as the next review to do for my Brown Skin Friendly Mineral Sunscreen series. So today we're gonna be talking about specifically my experiences with the Caught Sensitive Skin Untinted Mineral Sunscreen and how it compares to the Caught Flawless Complexion Tinted Mineral Sunscreen. But before we get into it, I'm gonna ask that you hit the subscribe button and notification bell so that you know when I post more skincare, sunscreen, and fancy related content on my channel. Give the video a thumbs up and down below in the comments again. I know you guys probably commented on the last one, but tell me, have you tried this one? What your experiences are with this one? How it compares to the Flawless Complexion Tinted Sunscreen if you've tried that one?
Sound off.
So right off the bat, looking at the packaging, just comparing the two sunscreens to each other, this one you're getting a little bit more product, but this one's also specifically intended for face and body, whereas the other one wasn't. You do get a little bit less protection with this one, SPF 40 compared to the SPF 50 of the tinted version. And this one is also water resistant for up to 40 minutes, it says. Besides that, this has no tint. But based off the claims from Caught themselves, they're really claiming this to be translucent, leaving a soft, sheer finish. And being Caught's features only titanium and zinc oxide. This one specifically is only zinc oxide at 20%. What I find really weird is the Flawless Complexion was specifically intended for sensitive skin, and yet this one has it right up front on the front of the packaging. So I really wonder what specifically designates this one to be even more so sensitive skin friendly. Explaining how I do my mineral sunscreen reviews on this channel, I go off my 4B's mineral sunscreen testing rubric, where I test for beard, beading, beet, and brown skin friendly. Beard, how it plays with facial hair. Beading, any weird textures and does it play weird with skincare. Beets, how it plays with makeup, how it affects makeup application, makeup wear, and makeup finish. And then brown skin friendly, is it brown skin friendly? And if so, to what degree? You're gonna see me doing application footage over 4 days. Each day I apply roughly 1/4 teaspoon to cover my face, my ears, and my neck. Work it in for a few minutes, let it sit in for at least 5 minutes, and then I go on top of it with anything else for that day. The first 3 days, I'm fluctuating skincare and makeup on top, so that I can see if those factors and variables affect the overall experience with the sunscreen. And then day 4 is nothing but the sunscreen on my skin, so you can see how it looks on bare skin, and more so how this reapplies on top of itself after a few hours of wearing it. And with that, let's get into the wear tests. Day 1, always the first day of me trying this out. For those days, I measure out the 1/4 teaspoon, and then I apply it only to half of my face, so that you can see after it's set for 5 minutes, how that compares, and it does leave a white cast. You can see on screen what that looks like. Day 1 is a light skincare day. So for this day, I just did a layer of a hydrator, a serum, and then the sunscreen on top. So with the day 1 half face application, you can see on screen whether or not it left a white cast. To me, it looked okay. It definitely was not as translucent as the Flawless Complexion, but more so, especially because my boyfriend, I always have him look at my applications afterwards. He was like, oh, I see this one in your beard and your facial hair, and I can kind of tell you have something on. And I was like, okay. I did the full face application. Day 1 is always a light beat day, so I did some Fenty matchsticks on top of it, and I feel like that was fine. But real talk, it's just the sunscreen had such an emollient finish that I was like, oh, this is gonna be an issue. With the makeup went on nice. I just feel like the sunscreen's radiance really shone through, and no matter how much I set my face, it just was never really set. I was very radiant, I was very dewy, I have oily skin. So I was like, okay, this might be an issue going forward. But at the end of the day, it was just really greasy. Day 2 is my full skincare underneath. I'm talking layers of hydrators, serums, moisturizers, and the sunscreen on top, and then a light makeup application on top. And the issues I had with day 1 of the sunscreen being really emollient and being really radiant was more so exacerbated day 2 with everything else underneath it. I feel like this didn't really set down into my skin well, just because there was so much underneath it, but I am more oily skin. And as a result of that, makeup just was really radiant, very greasy, very shiny. And I think this was the day when I was talking to my boyfriend, he was like, oh, it's like breaking up right around your nose, which is a common issue with sunscreens that aren't very compatible to my skin. You can see the beginning and end of day footage. It's just, it's very shiny. Day 3 is my light skincare, but full beat. That is full coverage, concealer, bronzer, contour, all that stuff. With these days, I do wear primer on top of the sunscreen underneath the makeup to see how primer plays. And I don't feel like primer was an issue. I also press it into my skin using a sponge. But here's the thing, with this day specifically, because I was doing full coverage B and all that makeup, I was like, let me bake, and I never bake. And I baked and then reset my face twice over as I was completing my face and doing the whole thing. And no matter how many times I set my face in the makeup application process, I was always radiant again within a couple minutes. And then throughout the day, the issue just got worse. and I got more breakup around my nose again. My eyelids got really, really creasy, and it was just a very radiant sunscreen, and it shone through even with all the matteness, all the matte products, all the powder. Day four is nothing but the sunscreen, and you can see on the screen, I'm applying it on my bare face, working it into my skin, letting it set down, and I was like, okay, you know, as much as I've been worried about the makeup applications, this is the day where I can see how the sunscreen does its thing, and I was like, oh, this is not bad. It's definitely has a really radiant finish, but in terms of white cast, I was like, okay, this is workable, this is doable. And then I did the reapplication about 3 hours later, and I was, on the one hand, very shocked. When I worked it in, right on the initial application of the reapplication, I was like, oh, this is not gonna be good. And I would remember rubbing it into my skin, and I was like, this isn't dissipating quickly. I did my usual spread and pat, which is how I work in mineral sunscreens if I try to make them a little bit more functional for my skin. After a few minutes, I think I waited roughly 7 to 10 minutes with this one. I was like, oh, this is okay. It was a little bit worse in my hairline and beard line, but that's not necessarily an issue. I actually do have these kind of issues with mineral sunscreen reapplication. The problem was how greasy I was. And you can see on the screen, I show my hand after that reapplication, and my hand is just covered in grease. Like, it looked like I stuck my hand in a vat of oil. And you can see more so when I was touching my phone, I noticed it was this weird situation where the oiliness was just beating up on my phone. And one thing that's interesting about these more emollient sunscreens is, like, I can apply them to my face and I can blot them down. That's not an issue. But it's around my ears where it becomes a really big problem, because it's just so greasy, and then I like go to scratch my ear because I feel it on my ear, and in my ear I just hear that sound, and it's just overall not a fun experience. So that leads me to my 4 B's testing rubric and how the sunscreen measured up to it. First B, beard. This was not horrible in my hairline, beard line, mustache, facial hair. It just wasn't as good as the flawless complexion. But that being said, I've definitely had a lot worse. This, the texture of it, is just nice, creamy, and emollient. I find that's a little bit more of a pleasant texture to work into a hairline and a beard line. And especially on the days where I did a lot behind my ears and around the back of my neck, and I had a noticeable amount in that hairline back here. If I just like really worked it in, I was all right. That being said, I actually didn't go into broad daylight. And that's usually a really big indicator as to how severe that looks, so I can't necessarily attest to that, but this was okay. Second B, beading. How it works with our skincare as your weird texture issues. Again, similar to the flawless complexion, this is a really nice, creamy, emollient texture. A lot of dimethicones in this one. So it's smooth, it's creamy, it goes on like butter. There's no issues with texture or pilling. It's just a matter of, because I have very oily skin, this doesn't set down into my skin very well or easily, especially if I got other emollients underneath it. So be weary of that. Third B is beads, how it plays with makeup, how it affects makeup wear overall. Makeup applies nicely on top of this if this is my only like moisturizing step. I can go with this on bare skin and wait a while and maybe blot afterwards and then I could be okay. But the thing is, this just was so radiant and so oily and so greasy that it really affected how my makeup wore, how it felt, how it looked. Not necessarily so much how it applied. I've had worse experience for sure. But it's just, I was so shiny all the time and I felt this on my face. And whenever I had this on, especially with a full beat, I just could not wait to wash my face at the end of the day. So if you have dry skin and you want a really moisturizing base for your makeup, this will be a really good option. The white cast and lighten or make the foundation look very gray. This did make things really greasy, and as a result of that, I feel like it really aided in the breaking up of the foundation around my nose and stuff. So this is not oily skin compatible with makeup, even if your makeup's mad matte, even if you bake, even if you reset your face throughout the day and blot. This just did not work in that regard to me. And then fourth B, brown skin friendly. And this is the point of contention, because here's a T. The bar was already set so high with the flawless complexion that I can tell, I can prove, I got the receipts that that is a very, for the most part, inclusive sunscreen. I had the receipts to prove it's very, very compatible up until like the Fenty 470 range, for sure. This one on me, on certain occasions, on certain days, I could tell this was on my skin, but it wasn't a very overt white cast, especially where I can tell is under my eyes generally. I feel like with how my under eye darkness works, even if a sunscreen has minimal to no white cast, I can always tell I have something on down here for some reason. It's okay for me. I know my friend Rotten Skin here on YouTube really likes this sunscreen, and it's one he actually uses very regularly. It's one of his holy grails, and he's very close in skin tone to me, so that's something. It's okay up into this mid-range skin tone, but I really do not have receipts for deeper, darker skin tones, but I am going off my gut instinct that this maybe is not the best option, and this will have a white cast on deep, dark skin tone, so. And so my final thought on the COTS Sensitive Non-Tinted SPF 40. This is not oily skin friendly. This is for dry skin. I just honestly cannot understand the difference between why this one's designated for sensitive skin specifically, whereas the Tinted Flawless Complexion version is also good for sensitive skin, so I don't get why they're advertising these differently. This is water resistant, which for a lot of people is definitely a plus. This is a really great option if it's a really hot, high UV index day, you are sweating, working out, going to SeaWorld, I don't know. But in terms of like wearability, inclusivity and all that stuff, the Flawless Complexion is definitely the winner in my mind. This is great if you have dry skin, and if you have really sensitive skin, you know what? Maybe this is good for you. In terms of everything else, this is 3.5 ounces, aka 100 grams for $25. You can only really get this in the US. I'm based in the UK, and again, thanks to State of Kate, that's the only reason I have this. Honestly, full tea, full disclosure, full opinion, because this just does not hit all the metrics I want, and I had a much better experience with the Flawless Complexion. This is just not Ramon recommended necessarily. I had a much better experience with the other one, and I actually couldn't see myself using the other one a lot more. This one, I'm probably gonna give away. She's greasy, she's not cute, she's not the most cosmetically elegant, so. So with that, that's my opinion of the Caught Sensitive Non-Tinted SPF 40, face and body, water resistant, all that. Not my favorite, she's not cute, better option with the Flawless Complexion. Make sure you hit the subscribe button and notification bell so that you know when I post more skincare, sunscreen, and fancy related content on my channel. Give this video a thumbs up and down below in the comments, have you tried this? What are your thoughts on it? I definitely understand why everyone was saying all the stuff they were saying about how greasy this was, because it is, and if you have those issues, the Flawless Complexion does not have those same problems. But also down in the comments, you can sound off, tell me what you think, tell me what you thought, and what your experiences are. Thanks for watching, guys. Bye.